Chapter 10. Heading to NAM.
Let's see. After graduating OCS and jump school, they sent me to Fort Campbell, Kentucky, home of the 101st Airborne, to continue training till I got my orders. In December of 67, I was shipped to Vietnam, which was just in time for the Tet Offensive. We started out in Benoit, a major air base in the south that had almost everything you'd find back in the States. An officer's club, mess hall, PX. You could almost forget you were out of the country, until the nightly mortar and rocket attacks reminded you this was no vacation. While there, I was given my first platoon leader assignment and put in charge of the 3rd Platoon of Charlie Company, 1st 501 2nd Brigade. To be platoon leader in charge of an airborne unit was really something special because paratroopers were all volunteers. That meant I had the top-notch soldiers. As a 23-year-old officer, I was considered an old person in Vietnam. There were guys as young as 17 in my platoon. Shit, we later found out there was a 15-year-old kid who doctored up his birth certificate to get into the Marines. So you got all these young guys, and they're armed to the teeth. They can kill everything in sight if they want to. And you have to control that, so they fight and kill when you want them to. Otherwise, all hell broke loose. Because if somebody starts shooting in a situation, what'll happen is they'll all start shooting, and the next thing you know, they're shooting everybody in sight. You don't want that. You need to be able to direct that fury where you want it to go. That was just one of the challenges of being a platoon leader, but it was the most important, because you had the power of life and death. If you said somebody lived, they lived. If you said they died, they died. It was just like being in the Roman Colosseum. When we first got to Vietnam, they gave us this long briefing and said, well, you might see the enemy once every couple of weeks or so. You may not see them for long periods of time. Well, a couple of weeks later, the NVA and VC launched the Tet Offensive, and everything changed real fast. When Tet started, the balloon went up everywhere. The Tet Offensive was intended to get the South Vietnamese to basically turn to the North and say, okay, we're going to rise up with you and rebel, throw these Americans out, and take over. That's when they flew us north to the base of Phu Bai, which was near the imperial city of Hue. Hue was once the capital of Vietnam, and it was an ancient city surrounded by a huge wall, built like a medieval castle with its citadel surrounded by ramparts and moats. By the time we arrived, Hue was already under assault by 2 Vietnamese and 1 Viet Cong regiment. There were probably around 11,000 enemy troops massed in Hue at that time. It was still the early days of Tet, and the Marines were in there fighting it out. We started operating around the outskirts of Hue. The only way I could describe it was like stepping into the bowels of hell. There were civilian and NVA bodies lying and rotting everywhere you looked. The fighting was so intense, nobody was even thinking of recovering bodies. The sound of gunfire and explosions were nonstop, and the volume was absolutely deafening. You could feel the explosive concussions constantly vibrating through your body and shaking your internal organs. Working on the outskirts of the city, we were engaged in one of the most dangerous of military maneuvers, trying to contain a trapped and desperate enemy. Actually, a pretty large contingent, maybe a whole enemy regiment, eventually escaped over the Citadel Bridge, crossing the Perfume River into the mainland. We called it the Perfume River because in the fall, tropical flowers would drop into the water and float downstream, wafting fragrant smells onto the banks of the city. But the only thing I remember smelling during that time was the pungent, rotting stink of dead people. After the NVA escaped, they blew up the bridge behind them. They figured the Americans wouldn't be able to continue chasing them, but shit, we didn't let that stop us. We crossed the river and were right on their heels. We spent the next 30 days chasing large North Vietnamese units that were retreating out of Hue and other towns in the area. Most historians will say that the Battle of Hue was the bloodiest battle in all the war, and on that, I would have to agree. Our platoon and every other company would put out ambushes every night, and the NVA couldn't help themselves from getting caught in our traps. It was like throwing a net into a pond, overflowing with fish. Although these weren't regular fish in our nets, they were a lot nastier, more like piranha. Right around then was the first time I was wounded in combat. I got hit with some shrapnel from a grenade. We were stopped in a Vietnamese village when some sappers busted through our perimeter. Sappers were basically Vietnamese kamikazes, soldiers with explosives on their backs that ran headfirst into your perimeter. They killed 2 of our guys on one position, and then started to infiltrate our whole unit, but we eventually got them out of there and killed close to 10 or 15 of them. The next day we decided we weren't going to wait to be hit. We'd bring the fight to them. So, in the morning, as soon as dawn broke, We started in pursuit of this NVA unit. We did this for most of the day into the early afternoon hours, humping through some of the worst terrain imaginable, until we eventually came into this small, deserted village. Even though it was deserted, it still had the strong, rotting, oily fish smell of their favorite sauce, Nuoc Mam, mixed with the peanut buttery smell of their chewed betel nut. The villagers chewed the betel nut, which supposedly had a caffeine effect, and it also caused their teeth to turn a reddish black. There was always a corner inside their huts, dedicated just for spitting the juice into. My platoon was the lead element. When we came into this village, I started noticing AK-47 rounds scattered around on the ground, just like someone was throwing out breadcrumbs for us. We tracked it for about 100 meters until I got this bad feeling and halted the platoon. I knew something wasn't right because we were following a trail they wanted us to follow. I radioed my company commander and told him that I thought it was a trap. He agreed and ordered us to move off the trail and over to the end of the village to set up a defensive firing position. I then ordered everyone in my platoon to fix bayonets to their rifles. I said, "Before we get into our firing positions, probe everything in the village. Probe every haystack, every sack of rice, and check for any kind of booby traps. Also look for spider holes, anywhere they can hide, because we don't want them behind us. If you think fighting an enemy waiting in front of you in ambush is bad, that's nothing compared to Charlie sneaking up your ass." Charlie was what we called anyone who looked even remotely suspicious in Nam. So, after probing everything, we moved to the edge of the village near this big hedgerow. That's where I had my guys set up in firing positions. My company commander raised me on the radio and advised that he'd ordered 1st Platoon to leapfrog us and for us to make sure our fire support was ready for him. So, we're trying to set up our fire support, but the area is too flat. We had no way of getting elevation over 1st Platoon, which would soon be in front of us. Tactically, it was really bad, but out there you had to improvise on the fly and make do. Despite the disadvantage, 1st Platoon goes through as ordered, and the first thing they do is recon by fire. By indiscriminately firing their rifles and launching M79 grenades ahead of them, they were hoping to lure the enemy into giving away their position, tripping their ambush before it was sprung. Well, those M79 explosive rounds must have got one of those NVA soldiers nervous. He started shooting before he was supposed to shoot. 1st Platoon was only about 40 yards into the field when that soldier let loose with his AK-47. It's a good thing that happened, because if 1st Platoon moved another 50 yards forward, they would have walked straight into the killing zone. So the early warning gave them a chance to hit the ground and dive behind cover. Even so, a lot of those guys got hit, because the NVA still had the jump on them. Even back where we were, we started taking casualties. The amount of enemy gunfire coming in was so heavy, it was like a wall of lead slamming into us. In the first 10 seconds of battle, I lost my machine gunner. Like losing an essential piece on a chessboard before the game even starts. We needed to get some fire on that heavily infested enemy tree line, because they were chewing us up. Without my gunner, it was nearly impossible. I radioed the lieutenant running 1st Platoon, and I asked, "What's your situation?" He screamed, "I'm hit! I'm hit! And I got at least half a dozen people down out in this field!" So I grabbed a few guys and we ran up a trail that was along the right side. There was a little depression at the end of the trail, where we would at least have some partial cover. We hauled ass down that trail, jumping into the depression as the bullets chased us. I jumped back and forth several times from the depression up to the trail, firing on fully automatic. Every time I would jump back into cover, this NVA heavy machine gun would open up on us. Once I jumped up to start firing, and an NVA round actually hit my rifle. I had the feed tray up and my rifle in front of me. The rifle went flying back and slammed into my helmet, making a loud thudding noise. It knocked me flat on my ass. I then hear one of my guys yell out, "The lieutenant's dead!" As I'm lying dazed on my back, I actually saw the bullets slowly coming through the bamboo toward me. It was like one of those slow-motion movies. I saw the bamboo actually splitting, and I'm going, "Holy shit, I'm seeing even the smallest of details on that bamboo as it splits." The next thing I did was to start to feel around my body, thinking, "Where am I hit?" And I wasn't. I remember actually saying out loud to myself, "No, you're not hit. You're fine." I looked over to my radio operator lying next to me. They'd shot the shit out of his radio. It had 3 big bullet holes in it. But somehow, he was unhurt, just stunned. So I said, I'm going back to get the other radio. Well, when I jumped up, that machine gunner opened up on me again. He had me dead to rights and centered me with a burst, but I was just super lucky to dive at that exact moment. One round went through the cargo pocket of my pants leg. As soon as I hit the ground, a grenade blew up next to me, knocking me sideways several feet. I didn't feel any pain whatsoever until I tried to run and felt the searing agony of several pieces of large shrapnel lodged in my leg. The adrenaline kept me moving, and I brought back the other radio. We continued to fight, and we stayed out there. Because when you're in a fight, it's not like a John Wayne movie, you know? It doesn't go all silent so you can talk to the sergeant, tell him how you're feeling and about the girl you left behind. There were no breaks, no timeouts because I'm hurt. You had to fight, so we kept fighting. I was all bandaged up by this point. I don't even remember who bandaged me up, but most of my guys were pretty bad off. We then started to drag all our equipment and wounded out of there so we could call in an airstrike. After pulling back, I laid on my back in the wet grass, totally exhausted. Looking up, I could see those jets come screaming in, straight for the NVA. The NVA knew our tactics and tried to make a run for it out of the tree line. They were trying to run across a rice paddy to escape, but it's very hard to run in a muddy rice paddy, especially when you have two F-4 Phantom jets chasing you with miniguns. That's the last I saw of that battle. I was placed on a stretcher and loaded into a Huey helicopter for evac. There's something special about those helicopters, something rhythmic and alive. I don't think you can understand how much that Huey meant to us in the jungle. It was life and death itself. I was in the hospital for about 3 weeks before I was sent back to my platoon. The doctors wanted to sideline me for 6 weeks, but every day I kept telling them that I was fine. I wanted to go back to my unit, because that's when rumors started spreading that we were going to parachute jump into North Vietnam. I wanted to be back in time to be part of it.